So am I supposed to stand or
completely
sit or
up
whatever?
To you.
Yeah. Well, let me sit because you're sitting. Okay, so first of all, you know, let me apologize for the fact that my English sounds a lot like French. So I hope you can understand me. So I'm very glad to be here today. Very glad that we could set up this time for us to discussing. So I'm here initially. Primarily, I was here in Oxford to give a lecture. I think it's called the X lecture in economic history tonight. So maybe some of you will be there, but I guess most of you will not be there. So what I'm going to try to do in this little 15 minutes presentation is to give you a sense of what I'm going to be talking about in this lecture tonight, and a short summary. And then, you know, if you have questions, I'd be happy to tell you more. And you know, if some of you want to come tonight, you will have even more. I guess, yes, there are some slides here, although I'm not sure, and I don't know how much you will be able to see, but maybe let's, if you go to next one. Yes. Okay. So this is a picture showing the evolution of income inequality in a number of regions in the world, and I'm going to be commenting on that in a minute. But first of all, let me say, you know, generally speaking, in my research, I have been concerned with trying to understand the historical evolution of the distribution of income and wealth. And so this is a lot of archival work that, in effect, was not done before, I think largely for bad reason. You know, there was a lot of historical material on income and wealth, sometime dating back to the 19th century, 18th century, and certainly for most countries, the material was available throughout the 20th century, following the creation of a modern income tax system in the late 19th, early 20th century in most developed countries, and in a number of developing countries as well. But this material had never been used before, I think largely because this was viewed as too historical for economists and too economic for historians, so it was in a sort of academic no man's land and nobody was really using it. And so I started working on this material almost 20 years ago. I was very fortunate to find the support and friendship of someone who has spent a lot of time in Oxford, who was Tony Atkinson, and who unfortunately passed away early in 2017, and who was the first person to read my work on France. And then together we edited two big collective volumes that were published by Oxford University Press in 2007-2010, where we covered over 25 countries. Then the process has gone on, and now this has become a huge international research program where we've been collecting historical data on income and wealth inequality. I wrote this book, Capital in the 21st Century, that was published in 2014, that was based on part of this evidence. But we're still continuing, and today I'm going to show you some of the new research coming out of this program. So one of the big limitations in my book, Capital in the 21st Century, well, there are many, many limitations, of course, you know, it's just one book, and you know, I'm still young, so I'm still going to write many more books. But one of the obvious limitations is that it was very much Western-centric. Okay? It was very much centered on the case of Western Europe, North America, a little bit Japan, Australia, New Zealand, but basically there was very little outside of the West. I mean, it's not that I was not interested. To a large extent, it was for a lack of access to the relevant historical data. But it's a bit more than this. It's also that the story I was telling about the historical dynamics of inequality in capital in the 21st century was very much centered on the role played by the major shock of the 20th century, World War I, World War II, the Great Depression, the Bolshevik Revolution, and how it brought through a sequence of dramatic events and more positive political events with the development of the welfare state after World War II, to the reduction of inequality, in particular in Europe, which used to be very unequal up until 1914, particularly in Britain, but also in France and throughout Europe, and which in the 1950s stands at a much lower level of inequality. And so the story of the book Capital in the 21st Century is very much centered around World War I and World War II, but if you look at other parts of the world, you know, if you look at the dynamics of inequality, from the point of view of India, or from the point of view of Brazil or South Africa. You know, world wars, well, so-called world wars are mostly European wars, and their impact on the dynamics of inequality in India, in Brazil, you know, are rather limited. Well, this had some impact through the decolonization process that came after all of that, of course, but the you know, my book, not only in terms of data, but also in terms of political mechanism and basic historical narrative, is very much centered on the history of Europe. And that's a big limitation. And so what we've been doing in particular, so this is graph comes from the World Inequality Report 2018, which we just released 2 months ago. So you will get, if you go online at weird2019wid.world, and more generally, if you go to the website wid.world, wid.world, you will find the report, you will find the full database, with actually many more countries, in particular in the emerging world, which were not covered in my book, because we didn't have the access to the data at that time. And so on this graph, you see that in addition to Europe, which is a European wide level of income inequality, and US-Canada, which is a North American measure. You also have India, Russia, China, which typically are countries that, and we also have in the report the Middle East, which appears to be the most unequal region in the world in terms of distribution of income and wealth if you measure inequality at the level of the entire region. So one of the main novelties of this World Inequality Report is that we are now able to compare basically all the different regions in the world and to put the discussion of inequality into a more global perspective. Now, if we do this, one of the first results we get, if you look at this graph, is that you have rising inequality pretty much everywhere since 1980, but at very different speed across different countries, which is interesting because, you know, if the explanation for rising inequality was just, this is globalization and this is producing rising inequality, but there's nothing we can do about it because globalization is good and that's it, you know, you should have the same rise in inequality everywhere. The fact that you have very different speed in different countries, so typically rising inequality has been much stronger in the US than in Europe, you know, in spite of the fact that globalization, did not only happen in the US, it also happened in Germany, in Sweden, you know. So you have rising inequality in those countries as well, but it's much less strong than in the US. If you compare India and China, you will also see that the rise in inequality is much bigger in India than in China, which was not terribly successful in terms of total growth. So this is also, this comparison between India and China is interesting because it shows that, you know, if more inequality was always good for growth, you should have had more growth in India than in China. You know, the two countries had very comparable per capita income level at the beginning of the period. And India, in a way, got it all wrong in the sense that you have, at the same time, bigger inequality and less total growth. So, you know, from the point of view of the bottom half of the population, you really lose on both dimensions. So this means, again, this illustrates the fact that different policies can make a big difference for how the total growth coming from globalization is distributed across the population. So the bottom line and the basic conclusion from this first graph is there are different ways to regulate globalization, you know, different policies. So in particular, why is it that you have more unequal growth in India and China? Well, probably the policies in terms of investment in education, in health, in public infrastructure, were more egalitarian in China than India. It's not that they were completely egalitarian, but at least say the bottom half of the population, or the bottom 60 or 70% of the population, got more educational investment. If you look at health spending, there's no doubt about this, than in India, where the bottom part of the population did not make enough progress and did not benefit from sufficient investment over this period. So if you go online on this website, you will have a lot more details about the different country cases. What I want to point out is that something that had not been done before, which we do in this report, is to compare inequality across big world regions. You know, usually people very much concentrate on inequality at the level of the nation state, Or sometimes they look at the entire world. So we also look at the nation state and we also look at the entire world, but we believe that, you know, in between the two, there are some big regions which are maybe more meaningful than either the nation state or the entire world. Well, you know, both all levels of analysis are relevant, and so we try to change the frontier, you know, from time to time when we make this comparison. One interesting implication is that, for instance, if you take the case of Europe, it is quite striking that here this includes both Eastern and Western Europe. So you do have, you do have Bulgaria with Germany. You do have, countries with very different income levels. Now, of course, putting Bulgaria with Germany increases the total level of inequality. That's for sure, but not that much. And in fact, even after you do that, the total level of inequality in Europe is much less than in the US. In fact, when we make the comparison with the US, probably we should also include Mexico, you know, which, well, I'm not saying Mexico is the equivalent of Bulgaria for Germany, but in a way, you know, if you, it's the periphery of the big economic region, and in terms of total population, total Europe is 550. So UK is in the Europe, of course, here on this graph, and, you know, I hope for a long time, but so if you only compare to the US, which is only 300 million, you know, it will be legitimate actually to add Mexico, and then inequality in North America would be even higher. So why is it legitimate to compare these big regions? Well, because even though they don't have a common government, a common policy, they do share common institutions, they do share sometimes trade agreement, sometimes migration agreement, so under different arrangements, you know, you have more free mobility in Europe than in North America, of course. Maybe this has also something to do with the outcome in terms of inequality. So this also creates other problems, and some people may be unhappy about this, of course, but there are also other dimensions of policies, including regional investment funds, which, you know, you don't have in North America, or at least you may, you know, you can have it to some extent within the US, because a lot of the federal budget in the US is doing, in effect, a lot of redistribution between Louisiana and California, etc. But if you take a broader perspective, this is much less so. Another interesting comparison, which I don't have in this graph, is with the Middle East. So here, you know, you do have regional political institutions with the Arab League, but in terms of actual redistribution, they don't do much. So you have redistribution, you know, in the sense that the Egyptian government is regularly begging the Saudi government to lend money, but the institutional arrangements through which this takes place, you know, is far from satisfactory and is very insufficient. And, you know, I don't want to seem as if I want to explain everything with inequality, and I'm certainly not saying that the fact that the Middle East in our report is the most unequal region in the world is the only explanation for the political instability of the Middle East. That would be a very stupid statement, but at the same time, I think it can contribute to exacerbate the tension, and to me, this is really the biggest danger with very high and uncontrolled inequality, that it tends to fuel tension within countries, sometimes between countries. I think the very high level of inequality that we had in Europe until 1914 did contribute to the fierce nationalist competition between countries and tension within countries. And today, if you look at the Middle East, it's clear that some of the very large inequality within the Middle East did lead, in some cases, directly to invasion of countries by others, which were partly motivated by the redistribution of resources. If we move to the next slide, so here you only have US, Europe, and Japan, and you can see how the period of rising inequality after 1980 came after a period between 1950 and 1980 of relative equality. So again, the numbers, let me say just a few words about the numbers. Here, the simple indicator of inequality we are looking at is the share of total income going to the top 10% of the population. So if you had complete equality, it should be 10%. If you had complete inequality, it should be 100%. So, of course, in practice, it's in between 10 and 100. But as you can see, this can vary quite a lot. You know, if you think of the previous graph, it could go from 20% in the most equal to 60 or actually even 70% in the Middle East. So it goes pretty much the whole spectrum. I mean, not quite from 10 to 100, but it goes from 20 to 70. So here you can see that the historical period of relatively low inequality between 1950 and 1980 came after the 1914-1945 period of very large shocks. Before World War I, there was no tendency for reduction in inequality, which is probably one of the most important findings which influence a lot my view on the historical dynamics of inequality, in particular, in France, up until 1914, there was a rising concentration of property, and which is interesting because France, my home country, likes to present itself as a country that has been in love with equality since the French Revolution, etc. But there's always a lot of hypocrisy behind this kind of statement, both 100 years ago and today. And it's interesting actually for the political, for the record, that this kind of statement was used in France before World War I to justify the fact that France was actually the very last Western country to create the income tax, and the law creating the income tax in France was passed during the summer of 1914, the law of July 15, 1914, and it was passed not to get income tax revenue to invest in schools, but rather to go to war with Germany. Okay, this was the only reason why at the end the French Senate accepted to vote the income tax. Whereas in Britain, there had been an income tax since the middle of the 19th century. It became a full-blown progressive income tax in 1908, so not that much before, but that was in peacetime. That was not for the pressure of war, so it's quite a different political process. In the US, the federal income tax was created just 1 year before the war in 1913, but this had nothing to do with the war. Again, this took a long time because you had to reform the US federal constitution, which initially made it impossible to have an income tax at the federal level. It was a very long process, but in the end, the process went until its term, and federal income tax was passed in peacetime in 1913. In Germany or Sweden or actually Japan, you had income tax that were passed even before that in the 1880s, 1890s. So France was really the very last country to. And the big argument at the time by the French Republican elite and political elite was to say, well, look, we've done the French Revolution, so that's enough, basically. We don't need an income tax, because we are already a country of equals. We have created equality through redistribution of land or whatever at the time of the revolution. So, why would we need an income tax? Whereas British, the Britain, of course, this is such an unequal aristocratic country, they should have an income tax right away. Germany, this is an authoritarian country. They are not democratic. They should have an income tax. But we, France, we are the country of equality, liberty, etc. No need for an income tax. Except that the historical data that I've used shows that, in fact, the concentration of wealth and income in France at the eve of World War I in 1913 is just as large, almost as large as in Britain, because at that time, the aristocratic landed estates already don't matter anymore. What matters is the accumulation of wealth in much more modern part of the economy, foreign investment, stock market, equity, real estate in Paris and London, and the laws governing the accumulation and distribution of wealth have little to do with the fact that you are a monarchy or a republic, and I'm very happy to be in a republic, but this, what matters more is whether you have a progressive tax on income, on inheritance, on wealth. So there was a lot of hypocrisy in France, but in big part of the European elite in the end, and it's only after these big shocks of World War I, World War II, the Great Depression, that attitudes towards the market and attitudes toward laissez-faire capitalism and private property change so much that you have a reduction of inequality. If you look at the following slide, in the recent period, maybe the most spectacular evolution, if we look at the rise in inequality, is this complete collapse of the bottom income group in the US. So the US, which for a long time were actually not more unequal than Europe, a century ago, so these things change, in the recent decades have become really a lot more unequal than Europe, as we have seen on the previous graph. And you can see that the rising top income shares at the bottom, at the top, corresponds to a massive collapse of the bottom share at the bottom, which is really quite striking. This also shows that the rising inequality at the top is not only a matter of symbolic, you know, justice issues. You know, it's not just, if it was just a few, you know, individuals, football players who are making a couple of million a year and who are giving us a good show, and you know, that would be nice. But here, the price to pay for the show is really quite large, you know, because the magnitude of the increase in this top 1% income share, going from 10 to 20% of total income, is just the comparable, almost exactly the same as the collapse in the share going to the bottom 50%. So how is it that the top 1% share can be twice as high as the bottom 50%? Well, it's because the average income of the top 1% is now almost 100 times, well, 80 or 90 times the average income of the bottom 50, so, whereas it used to be less than 50 times higher, about 20 times higher, 30 times higher at the beginning, so their share was twice as small. You know, it's a very simple arithmetic. You know, you have to see whether the 50 times difference in size is more or less compensated by the difference in average income. It's as simple as that. So you can find all the data online. Why is it that inequality has increased so much in the US as compared to Europe? Okay, there are many different factors that are involved, and we're not going to solve this question today. I don't know how much longer you want me to talk, but probably...
As long as you like.
Well, don't say that, because, you know... for how long have I been talking?
About 5 more minutes, if that's right.
Five more minutes. Okay, that's fine. So why is it that you have such a big rise in inequality in the US? Well, part of the explanation is probably unequal access to education. Generally speaking, is probably one of the most important factor in inequality. So if you go to the next slide, this is a pretty spectacular graph relating parental income rank to access to higher education in the US. So what you have is, on the horizontal axis, you have your parental income rank. So basically, you can be in the bottom 10%, top 10% of parental income rank. And on the vertical axis, you have the probability to access higher education. So this is the situation as of today. Well, this was measured for people that were in university between 2012 and 2015. So this is almost today. So as you see, you know, this is very striking, because you get almost a straight line, and this is almost the first diagonal. Okay, so it goes almost from 0 to 100%. Well, not quite. Okay, if your parents are in the bottom 10%, you still have a 20% chance to make it, and if your parents are in the top 10%, you only have a 95% chance to make it. Okay, so it's not exactly the first diagonal, but it's very close. And of course, this is actually an understatement, because these different groups of people don't go at all to the same universities. Okay, so when you are in the bottom, you go to university, you will go to an underfunded community college, whereas in the top, you will tend to go to Ivy League schools with you know, investment per student that can be 5 times bigger or more than in the you know, 2-year community college. So we are talking about an enormous gap in you know, access to higher education, which, you know, I think this is very striking, because this illustrates the fact that sometimes there is an enormous gap between the official discourse about equal opportunity, meritocracy, which we all agree with, you know, of course, and the reality of what we do. Okay, so I think, you know, there's a lot of imagination by the elite to justify inequality and to have big theoretical statements about equal opportunity, which have just nothing to do with the world in which we live. And so I was talking earlier of the hypocrisy of the French elite in 1914, but you know, you have this today, well, in the US, or actually in my home country, of course, in France, and pretty much everywhere. So I think it's important to put this kind of statements on equal opportunity, etc., under public scrutiny, and to have access to the relevant administrative data, so that we can measure not only the evolution of inequality in itself, but also the evolution of differential access to public services, either education, health, other public infrastructure, and so this was, you know, this was not in my book, again, because the data did not exist at the time of the book. And my friend and colleague Emmanuel Saez and Raj Shetty at Berkeley and Stanford were able actually to link up the income tax declaration of the parents with the social security number of the students in the universe of US schools and universities, so that they can show it. So, and I cannot show you the same graph for Britain or France, because we don't have access to the same data. The imperfect evidence we have suggests that it will be a bit less extreme, But the, you know, the curve will of course be upward sloping as well, but a probably a bit less extreme than what we have here in the US. But you know, it doesn't mean that we should just be happy with what we have. I think we need to be a lot more demanding in terms of public transparency in order to formulate policy objectives which then can be evaluated and then can be confronted with evidence. So I think it's, I don't know, maybe one day we'll be able to have elections and government accountability where you say, okay, well, this is the starting point. Where do you want to get us? Can we check at the end of your mandate where we are or 10 years later? Or if you want to stay there, just tell us that this is the best we can do and tell us that you want to stay there. But, you know, let's be explicit and not just have general discourse about equal opportunity, blah, 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 etc. Okay. So this is part of the policy that can make a difference for inequalities. There are many other policies. Maybe if you go to the next graph, this is a brief history of income tax progressivity over the 20th century. So here you have the top income tax rate applying to the highest level of income for five countries, the US, UK, Germany, France, Japan, throughout the 20th century. So you can see that one century ago, there was basically almost no income tax, and actually many people in 1900, 1910 thought that the income tax would never happen. And then it happened, and then it became really very progressive. So in particular, you can see, so Britain and the US, you know, went to the most progressive form of income tax. So if you take, so you all know about the case of Britain, or many of you know about the case of Britain. The case of the US is also interesting. Between 1930 and 1980, on average, the top income tax rate in the US was 82%. Okay? Sometimes it was up to 91% under Roosevelt, sometimes it was only 70. If you take the average, it was 82. And this was only the federal income tax. In addition, you have state income tax of 5 to 10%, to which are not even included here. Okay. But if you take the federal income tax rate, the top rate was on average 82% between 1930 and 1980. Now, apparently, this did not destroy American capitalism. If anything, productivity growth between 1950 and 1980 in the US was actually twice as large as what it has been since the 1980s. So to the extent that productivity growth is a useful measure of what we care about in terms of economic performance, you know, it suggests that the effects were not so bad. So I know that, you know, many people are not ready for a quiet conversation about this. You know, it's always very difficult to have a quiet conversation about taxation. You know, people get very excited very fast. But these are facts, and I think it's important to re-enter this debate. Britain, you know, each country has its own narrative as to what worked well in the past, what didn't work well. I think in the case of the US, I don't think this very high top income tax rate were any, you know, thing like detrimental in terms of growth, as I just said. In Britain, I don't think this was the major problem in Britain in the 60s or 70s. I think the problem had more to do with the lack of proper investment in education, in particular a very elitist system, other issues regarding labor regulation, which probably were more important than this tax problem. But you know, this is a very controversial area, and it will always be, and that's perfectly fine with me. But at least I think it's important to have this historical perspective. Okay, this is about income taxation. If you look at the next slide, you have a comparable evolution for the taxation of inherited wealth. So again, you can see that, you know, US and Britain at the highest level of tax progressivity with the top tax rate on very large inheritance around 70%, 80% during some period of time, whereas in France and Germany it was much lower. Now, of course, also these are different historical experiences. You know, in France and Germany, a big part of the redistribution of wealth during the 20th century was done through much more violent processes, through huge destruction of wealth during World War I, World War II, which were, you know, almost non-existent in Britain or the US, huge inflation, which destroyed a lot of private nominal wealth, huge expropriation also in 1945. So, you know, much more violent way to redistribute wealth, which is also why France and Germany did not use progressive taxation as much as Britain and the US. I mean, I tend to prefer progressive taxation, you know, which I think is a more civilized manner to do it. So I tend to prefer the US and British way in the 20th century. But anyway, this is part of our legacy. Look, Germany, if you look both on this graph and also on the previous graph, if you return to the previous graph, you will see that the only time, so Germany is in green, the only time when you have an 80% top tax rate in Germany is between 1946 and 1948, which is when the income tax of Germany was set by the Americans through the Allied Control Council, and they did the same in Japan. And the Americans were not doing that to punish the German or Japanese elites for what they did a few years before, because in fact they were having the same tax policy at home in the US. So this was not at all a punishment. In fact, in the US view of the time, this was part of the civilization package, so to speak. You know, you bring the democratic institutions together with the fiscal institutions that would prevent democracy from becoming a plutocracy. I know this can seem very exotic to some of you, but it is not so long ago. And these things will change again in the future. And I think the best thing we can do in order to try to contribute to the discussion about future evolution, which will take different forms with different institutions, and I'm not able to predict the future. But if we want to prepare ourselves to this important discussion, I think looking at this historical record and being aware of this historical record, which sometimes is not even the case, people don't recognize this, is important. So I'm going to stop here. There's a lot more material, in particular about the evolution of the structure of political cleavages, the rise of what I call the Brahmin left in some of my recent work, which I will talk more tonight in the lecture. If you have questions, I can also show you some material from this research right now. But for now, let me stop, and thank you all for your attention.
Thank you. All right, thank you very much for joining us and for your speech. So I'll ask a couple of questions before opening up to the audience. So you argued about the importance of having stronger institutions, and as your research in the coming years starts to focus more and more on developing countries, what role, if any, do you think democracy has to play in reducing inequality?
Well, that's a tough one as a first question, but I think the deliberation and the sharing of information and the sharing of power are of course ends in themselves and values in themselves, and have a value that is not only instrumental to other goals. So we really care about public deliberation, we care about voting rights, we care about decision rights and the equal distribution of power. So this has a lot of value in itself. Now, of course, it can also have an instrumental value in generating a more equitable policy and reduction of inequality. Now, the link, unfortunately, is not always mechanical, because it depends on what we really mean by democracy, free access to the media, how free is democracy. This depends also on the power of ideology, which is sometimes sufficiently strong to prevent redistribution from happening. Certainly, the experience from Europe, from that viewpoint, is a bit mixed, the historical experience, in the sense that you have universal suffrage from the 1870s to World War I. Well, not quite universal suffrage, but you have quasi-universal suffrage for male in some countries, for instance in France. And this does not really, as I was saying, in the end, it was only with World War I that you had this big redistribution, creation of the income tax. Why? Well, probably because the elite, as I was suggesting, were sufficiently powerful in their political discourse, their ideology. It's not only it's always complicated to know where to stop in terms of redistribution. So it's not, I'm not trying to say, you know, more redistribution is always good and the elites are always against it. You know, it's more complicated. You need to produce an intellectual platform, an ideological platform that makes sense, that is more convincing than the other one. So unequal access to the media can bias things in a certain way. Differences in power can bias things in a certain way, but it's always more complicated than that. So the link between democracy, reduction of inequality, unfortunately, you know, is not mechanical. And so instead of doing sometimes, you know, what economists do, you know, sometimes even political scientists, you know, huge cross-country regression with 100 countries and a democracy indicator on inequality, I think we have to open the black box a little more of what democracy really means and why it works, why it doesn't work, looking at more specific country cases. And also keeping in mind that democracy is also very important at the level of production, workplace, corporations, and not only, you know, for political elections, strictly speaking. So in particular, and I will stop here, there's a discussion that we are starting to have in France, and I believe also a little bit in Britain, about corporate democracy, and you know, should you have worker representative with voting right in the board of companies, which is something that Germany, Sweden, and Northern European countries put in place decades ago. And for a long time, you know, in France, you know, employers and shareholders, they didn't want to hear about this. You know, they would say, we don't want to have workers on board, or you know, they can be on board but with no voting right for any decision. You know, these people are dangerous people, they should be in the street, but they should not have voting rights on board. And then at some point, just during the past 10 years, especially because of the economic success of Germany, people started saying to, you know, French employers and shareholders, but you know, look, in Germany they have 1/2 of the seats in their board for worker representative, in Sweden it's 1/3, and you know, apparently it's not working so bad. You know, they seem to be able to involve workers in their investment strategy, in the corporate strategy in the company, in a way that seems to work better than you guys in your French companies where shareholders have all voting rights. So why don't you look, and why don't you introduce, and we are starting to introduce voting rights. So that's, you know, and that's, I think, the evidence is that this is actually useful to involve more the labor in the, so again, that's a controversial issue, but my understanding is that this kind of debate, you know, for a long time, it didn't come to countries like France or Britain, and in the US we are very far to have it, but you know, why not even in the US one day? And it's interesting to see how sometimes these kind of ideas spread at particular time and not in other times, in spite of the fact that this kind of corporate democracy or social democracy was in place in Germany or Sweden starting in the 1950s, 60s, so the discussion could have started long before. So these are some of the dimensions which I think are very important.
Sure. So speaking about democracy in France, as we approach a full year into Emmanuel Macron's presidency, some of his policies include replacing a wealth tax with a real estate levy and loosening employment laws, which makes it easier for companies to fire and hire employees. So what is your evaluation of his performance so far, first in general, and then in particular with regards to his economic policies?
Okay, well, I think he should have used his money differently. Well, he should have used our money differently, and he should have used our money to more to invest in education, in particular in higher education, rather than spend it on this suppression of the wealth tax, which I think was not useful, because you know, if you look at the data, you know, it's a very practical and pragmatic issues. If you look at the evolution of wealth in France, you know, top wealth groups have been doing very well. You know, not as well as in the US, but they've been doing very well in the following sense, you know, very precisely. You look at the average wealth in general, but even more so, top 1% wealth group, top 0.1% wealth group, they have increased. You look at the average wealth, they increased over the past 20 years, or 30 years, so since the creation of the wealth tax in particular, This has increased much faster than average income or per capita GDP, but also because usually when you say that, people say, oh, that's because of real estate boom, etc. Okay, except that this has also increased much faster than real estate prices. So if you look at average wealth of the top 1% groups, this has which is mostly financial assets. You know, real estate assets are important in the middle of the distribution, but if you look at, you know, above 2 or 3 million euros, or if you look above 10 million euros in wealth, real estate is less than 10% of total wealth. So when you suppress the wealth tax for financial assets, in effect, you are suppressing 90% of the wealth tax for the higher wealth. And what you see in the past 20 years is that, in fact, average wealth reported in these top groups has increased even more than average wealth below in the distribution, which itself, because of real estate, has increased a lot more than per capita GDP. So in other words, the tax base, you know, the idea that everybody is fleeing France with their wealth and that the tax base is disappearing is just factually completely wrong. You know, it's not there in the data. So maybe the tax base would have increased even more without, you know, Frenchmen going to London or Brussels or whatever. But all I can tell you, as this I cannot say, but all I can say is that already with what's left, it has increased hugely faster than the wage bills and all other incomes, all other assets. So when you have a tax base that's growing so fast, explaining that the priority is to get rid of the specific tax that's trying to get a little bit of money out of this tax base, you know, strikes me as completely crazy. Okay? This is just the opposite of economic rationality. I mean, so this is done in the name of economic rationality and economic pragmatism, but you know, it just doesn't pass you know, the simplest test you want. Now, this is a lot of money. Okay, the 5 to 6 billion euros per year of tax gift to the top income and wealth groups that were made, half of it through the wealth tax and the other half through dividend and interest tax reduction for top groups. So in total, it's about 6 billion euros per year. You know, this is, you could say, well, it's not much. Well, it's you know, it's almost, it's actually 40% of the total budget for higher education, for universities in France. So this is a lot of money. And if we had a lot of money that we could do both and we could reduce all tax and increase all spending, and, you know, of course, that would not be a problem. But given that we are not going to be able to spend the same money twice, And if you look at higher education, in particular in France, you know, the total budget has been more or less stable over the past 10 years. There's been a little bit of nominal increase, which sort of compensated the little inflation, but in real terms, the aggregate budget is stable, except that the total number of students has increased by 20%. Okay, so spending per student has declined by 20% at a time where everybody talks about human capital, innovation, etc. And so Macron certainly talks a lot about innovation and human capital. But you know, you have to do the investment other way. So we've put, you know, right now in France we have almost 80% of a cohort, or 70 to 80% of a cohort that goes at the end, till the end of high school to baccalaureate. It used to be 50%, you know, 10 years ago or 15 years ago. So this has increased very fast, which is good in itself, except that we've not increased the budget to have the university and the schools either 2 years or 3 years. Or, you know, you don't want everybody to go to a PhD, but at least you want the people who have done at the end of high school and who are applying to go for higher education, which they are all strongly advised to do. You need to have the relevant investment, which you don't have at all right now. So I think, you know, it would have been a better strategy to prepare the future. The other part of the Macron agenda, which is disappointing to me, is you know, the European agenda. Okay, there's a story right now in I don't know, in British media, but in the French media, basically the story is, okay, we have a fantastic president, you know, who has made a fantastic proposal to reform the Eurozone and the rest of Europe, but unfortunately, Germany and Netherlands and our neighbors are not as fantastic as our president, and they are not able to follow on this fantastic proposal, and this is really sad. So this is basically the narrative that you read every morning in the French media. And this is tiring to me, because there is no such proposal. Because there's been no precise proposal on Eurozone budget and Eurozone reform. And that's sad because we actually need to reform, you know, the Eurozone. You know, I've written, you know, I noticed that you made reference to the presidential campaign. So last year I was involved in a very particular part of the presidential campaign and the Hamon campaign, which was about reform of European treaties. So I wrote with a group of French European law specialists and political scientists. We wrote a proposal for a new treaty to democratize Europe, in particular to democratize the Eurozone. I'm not going to get into the details, but basically the idea is that the way we govern the Eurozone, and we've been governing the Eurozone crisis in the past 10 years, is not working. You cannot put around the table, you know, it's not enough to have around the table a group of finance ministers who in the middle of the night announced that they have saved the Eurozone for the 10th consecutive time in 10 years, and then the next day you realize that they don't even know themselves what they have decided during the night. And you know, you have no public deliberation, you have no... This is the Europe of the Congress of Vienne in 1815. This is not the kind of Europe that we want for the 21st century. So I think we need a Eurozone assembly, which in our view, in our proposal, should be based on members from national parliament, you know, the French National Assembly, the French, the German Bundestag, in proportion to the population and the different political groups, because in the end, these are the national assemblies that are voting the national tax and that have the legitimacy to actually put money together. You know, if we want to do something in the Eurozone to rescue Greece or whatever, at the end of the day, it will be the Bundestag, the French National Assembly, that will give the green light for the national taxpayer money. So given that all the different national parliaments have veto power, in effect, it's actually better to put all this veto power together to have a national assembly at the Eurozone level or at the broad European level, if one day, you know, everybody joins the Eurozone and Britain returns to Europe and everything is fine and everything is working, which of course is not exactly the what's going to happen in the short run. But anyway, this is the other, to me, this is the other big limitation of what Macron has been doing, is that, you know, he's pretending to make proposal for Europe, but if you look, dig into the details, you know, which are not details, which are important, there's actually no precise proposal. So there is no real discussion that has started in Europe so far on these difficult issues.
Perfect, thank you. So now we'll open up to a few questions from the audience. So if you have a question, please raise your hand and wait for the microphone to get to you. Please stand up and ask your question. So we can start with the lady in the first row, just over there.
Thanks, Professor Piketty, for talking to us today. I have a comment and a question. The comment is on the graph you showed of the income rank and the educational attainment in the US. And I just wanted to say that that's correlation, that's not causation. There might be something completely else going on that drives both factors. And my question is, I think you would agree that perfect income equality is not the goal either. And high income inequality as well as high income equality leads to, is not the best way to achieve high economic growth. So I'm wondering what your opinion is, like where the sweet spot is of how much income inequality is healthy to incentivize people to work and to have the economy grow.
Okay, well, thanks for both questions. Let me start with this one. Yeah, no, of course it's not causation because parental income comes from all sorts of other things. So, you know, you have inequality not only in parental income but also in parental education, in how much you know, cultural investment you have at home, etc. So we of course I agree with this. Now, does this imply that we cannot do better than this? You know, I think you would agree that this is really quite extreme. You know, now this is not, once you've said that, I agree that, you know, this is not saying what will be the ideal. You want to compare to other countries. So as I told you, unfortunately, we don't know very well, but there are some estimates for Denmark, and we can do some computation for France and Germany. The line will be much less steep. You know, it will still be rising, but it will not be as extreme. So this suggests and these countries, you know, in terms of total productivity, you know, GDP per hours of work are are roughly at the same level as the US, so but with less inequality. So this suggests that you know you can have you can have different choices, and that this is not this is not unavoidable. Because one interpretation behind your questions will be, well, you know, there's nothing we can do with this. It's just that unless you take the children away from the poor parents at birth, just have inequality in family transmission, in education, and you know that's it. Now, it is true that you know a lot of what can be done in terms of education has to be done early. So you know, investment in childcare, primary school is very important. But that doesn't mean that nothing can be done, at the level of higher education admission. You know, I think the evidence suggests that we can do better than this. But to me, you know, this is really an issue for the future. You know, how we think about higher education admission system. You know, how much do we want to take into account parental background in addition to the grades obtained by high school students, and how do we want to combine the two in order to regulate admission into higher education? I think this is some of the most important debates that we're going to need to have more and more in the future, and nobody has the solution. I certainly don't have the perfect solution, but I think no country has the perfect solution and can pretend to know. But this data will be one of the input to talk about this. This will not be the final input. Now, regarding the ideal level of inequality, so if we go back to the previous the next one. Yeah. Okay, so as I said, complete equality will be top 10% income share equal to 10%. Complete inequality to be 100%. So the optimum is certainly in between. So far, so good. We all agree. Where exactly in between? I don't know. I don't have a mathematical formula. My reading of the historical evidence is that when you have 30% in the post-World War II decades, it was actually quite a good compromise. Maybe we could have reduced this even more with better policies, in particular more egalitarian investment in education. But at least, I think that the increase in inequality that has happened since 1980 is mostly for bad reason. I don't see in the evidence I have, when I compare countries or when I compare companies that are paying their top CEOs $10 million rather than $1 million or $1 million rather than $500,000. And I'm sorry, but I don't see in the data the evidence for the extra productivity or the extra growth that would justify such an increase in equity. I just don't see it in the data. Now, this is not perfect data, and so I can perfectly understand that some other people looking at the same data draw different conclusions, but I've tried hard in my book, in other research, to bring more and more data so that we can have a more informed discussion about this. There will always be disagreement because we are in the social sciences. We will never come with a mathematical formula saying this is the tipping point, this is the... But at least I would like people who want to participate to this discussion to look at the data as well, because this is a discussion where people have very strong views, which is fine, this is what makes this discussion interesting, but sometimes they don't really engage in the discussion, they don't really look at the data, I think, seriously enough. So to summarize, going toward 50% or even more, 60-70% in Russia or the Middle East for the top 10% income share, I think is not socially useful in the sense that this is not bringing the kind of extra innovation, productivity that will be good for the bottom part of society and that will justify such an increased inequality. We can do better than this, I think.
Thank you. So we have time for one more question. So we'll go to the lady in the first row.
Thank you. In Capital in the 21st Century, you talk about an ideal end state of a global tax on wealth, but also the immense challenges of getting there. Have you seen any governments or organisations that are inching towards that? What's the best practice in getting more of a tax on wealth?
Well, there's been some progress in the fight against tax haven and financial opacity, but really much more limited than what some people pretend. So, I mean, let's get to the optimistic side. You know, I think it's there is some evidence in recent years that it's not so complicated to make progress. So if you think of, you know, bank secrecy in Switzerland, you know, people for many years said, okay, this will never go away. Switzerland is so powerful. How would they accept? And then it just took, you know, a few US sanctions to, you know, saying basically to Switzerland, well, if you don't change your law, you know, your banks will completely lose their banking license in the US. And the next day, Switzerland said, okay, well, then maybe we're going to change our law. So, you know, the good news is that it's actually not so complicated to have this kind of change. But the bad news is that it's not going to come just like this, you know, by having some polite discussion with the people who benefit from financial opacity. You know, you need to have some sanctions. And I think this is a big limitation, in particular in Europe, of the kind of talk we are having about how to fight tax evasion and how to fight the fact that many corporations or high wealth taxpayers are evading taxation, is that we're having you know, polite conversation, but we never we are never very serious about the sanctions. And so you know, in the case of Switzerland, yes, this was for the US, it was just the you know, the threat of losing the banking license. In the case of Europe, you know, Gabriel Zucman, who was teaching at Berkeley, has done some computation showing that the gains for Switzerland of the you know, the bank secrecy, or the remaining part of bank secrecy, because there's still a lot more that should be done, the gains for Switzerland are equivalent to the cost that will be imposed on Switzerland by approximately, I think, 15 or 20% tariff imposed by Germany, France, and Italy. So this is not an atomic bomb, but this is a pretty big sanction. And the problem is that we have been accustomed for so long that you can have free trade and free circulation of goods and services in exchange of nothing at all, you know, without any counterpart in terms of regulation, either fiscal, financial, environmental. You know, we've been accustomed for so long for the idea that you can have it all, you know, without that. For many people, it seems like unthinkable of having this kind of sanction. But you know, if you don't, I mean, the purpose is not. You know, I am in favor of free trade. But you need to have a sanction. You know, like in the case of the U.S. with the Swiss bank secrecy law, if you want to have results. So that's. I mean, you don't need a war. You don't need a you know, huge political shock. But you need real sanction more than talk. So is this going to happen finally? You know, I don't know. We'll see.
All right. Thank you very much. Unfortunately, that's all we have time for.